We are grateful for the Strings of Joy today and for their ministry and music. Wasn't that wonderful? Some of you remember when you played the violin and put it down too soon. We pray that our children will keep the violin going. Amen, someone. Well, I noticed what time it is. We made a promise to some of our friends that are visiting today. We told them they would talk about their church and what time they get out of church. And we told them, if you come to Brinklow today, we're going to get out by 1 o'clock. We will be out before 1 a.m. That is true. That is definitely true. We won't keep you that long. Dr. Lee, it's good seeing you. Dr. Harold Lee and Barbara Lee, thank you for worshiping with us. And we also have Dr. Roland Hill, his wife. Thank you for being with us today, for worshiping with us on the Sabbath day. It is quite a critical time in our Earth's history. In fact, it's so important. If you follow any religious blogs or information that's being spread by the media, there is a clarion call this weekend for pastors to occupy their pulpits and to speak for and often in opposition to the direction that the country is going in. And so pastors across this country are refusing to abide by the nonprofit status and remain neutral. And many of them are using their pulpits this weekend as their last opportunity to champion their cause, their political cause, to their congregations. Some churches that look like us, some ministers that look like me, are advocating to their congregations not to vote at all. Stay at home as a protest to the direction that they see things going in. Well, we have an opportunity today to do what perhaps in some of our immediate circles are historically and politically expedient. They say nothing. They treat this as a let's not get involved Sabbath. Let's not show our hands Sabbath. Let's remain neutral. Let's not rock the boat Sabbath. If you are that kind of Adventist, I will give you an opportunity to leave because you may be offended today. Because I do have this pastoral prerogative to preach God's word and to try to correct some of the erroneous concepts that are there, even if it's at a price. But it's an opportunity for us to wrestle with God and his word and to look at issues that are important to all of us. Now, let me be clear with you that this is not the time where I would suggest which candidate you support. God gives you that freedom of choice. And even the counsel received from the Pen of Inspiration is to vote, but to remember that that is a private and personal matter. Amen. And so, after much prayer, the Lord has led me down the road that we will travel today. Our sermon is entitled, The Politics of Jesus. The Politics of Jesus. Let us pray. Father in heaven, the lateness of this hour, I pray that you will energize your people to be hearers and doers of the word. So for these moments that we have in front of us, I pray that that which you have placed in my heart will be clear to your people, and that we will leave determined to do your will. Speak to us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The politics of Jesus. Our primary text, of course, is Luke 20, but before we get there, let me begin by just one verse that is a part of an important chapter when it comes to the Christian's understanding of government. That book would be the book of Romans, chapter 13. I just want to read verse 1, where the Bible says in Romans 13 and verse 1, everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Amen, someone. In other words, it is God who sets up kingdoms, and it's God who takes them down. He ultimately is in charge. I want to begin with that premises. The book of Luke, chapter 20, is our primary passage today. Luke chapter 20, verses 20 through 26. I too will read from the New King James Version of the Bible, where God's word reminds us, so they watched him. They watched him and sent spies who pretended to be righteous, that they may seize on his words in order to deliver him to the power and the authority of the governor. And then they asked him, saying, Teacher, we know that you say and teach rightly, and you do not show personal favoritism, but teach the way of God in truth. Is it lawful for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not? But he perceived their craftiness and said to them, Why do you test me? Show me a denarius or penny. Whose image and inscription does it have? They answered and said, Caesar's. And he said to them, Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God. But they could not catch him in his words in the presence of the people. And they marveled at his answer and kept silent. I want you to consider for a few moments as we look at the politics of Jesus. I want you to consider how the question was framed. Framing the question has everything to do with the direction of the discussion, in many cases, the outcome. Those who framed the question normally monopolize the platform and direct the discussion in a certain way. You see it all the time. Sometimes people ask questions when they already know their own answers. But they ask the questions sometimes to trip up people or give the impression they have a monopoly on truth, or they're trying to guide something in a certain direction. We see it often in Sabbath schools, where a question will have nothing to do with the lesson. Some pseudo-intellectual person is going to ask some off-the-wall question, trying to redirect the issue off of their issue onto something else. Consider those who frame the questions. What is interesting is Jesus is most familiar with handling questions. When you read the scripture, this is not the first time he's been presented with a question that seems in the mind of humans something insurmountable, but Jesus is always ready for the questions. You remember some of the questions. Who is my neighbor? As though Jesus couldn't handle that. This woman was caught in adultery. The law says that we ought to stone her. What do you say? Jesus can handle questions. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? He specializes in questions. What about the question from John the Baptist? Are you the one, or should we look for another? Question number 5 is, if a man dies and has no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise an offspring for his brother. But if this happens, all 7 brothers die, and the woman also dies, and in the resurrection, whose wife will she be? Jesus is used to the questions.
That's right.
Today we're dealing with question number 6, if you please. In Jesus' day, this was the critical, biggest issue at hand. This was the issue that divided people, that caused them to have conversations around the dinner table, that were looking for answers, wondering how this issue is going to be dealt with. And for the Pharisees, question number 6 was a perfect question to get Jesus. The question is it lawful for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not? We got them this time. We got them this time. I want you to consider a few issues that are critically important. It's not only important to look at those who framed the question, it's also important to look at the motive behind the questions. Jesus had already exposed the hypocrisy from the Pharisees. Jesus had already cleansed the temple. Jesus had already called them vipers and told them that they were nothing but walking dead men. Jesus had exposed their nothingness. Now their question was, we need to get back at Jesus. Always consider the motive behind the question in addition to the question. And then the Desire of Ages tells us something that's quite disturbing. That the Pharisees were used to bringing their old dogs to challenge Jesus. That Jesus was used to the statesmen in the church always challenging him, and Jesus always sent them away feeling less than intelligent. So Ellen White says that the Pharisees got young men, young people, to ask their questions. Lord have mercy. Let's poison the young people. Let's frame the question. Let's look at those who don't really understand what's behind the issue, and let's send them out to challenge Jesus. Oh, I wish we had time for that. I wish we had time to talk about how parents set up their children to ask questions of issues they can't deal with. How we pimp people and use people to raise issues that really are issues, because we know if we raise them, what the response is going to be. And so they use young men to ask this critical question. You must consider how questions are framed that impact not only the issue at hand, but also impact society. I want to suggest to you that a lot of the questions being raised today are being raised to impact not just the questions, but something else that is going on. Often people are used because people want power. So questions are raised that seem to impact people, but it really isn't about you as a person. It has everything to do with power. So if I can raise the issue of abortion, I can use it to get power. You got to understand the issue. And like the text says, that those who raise the question often appear to be religious people. Religious people in need of power are clamoring for power are some of the most dangerous people in the world. By any means necessary. Cloak in religiosity. Cloak under the guise that we're trying to do God's will. Cloak under what God expects. But behind it all is this thirst for more power and control. Amen, somebody. We can talk about in society, but Lord knows we sure enough can talk about in the church. Things that appear spiritual are really about somebody trying to get control. Get control. Are you still with me? You fall asleep yet? We have seen, it is interesting, when you look historically over how the notion of religious issues made their way into the political platform, there are many ways of looking at it. And a very brief, simple, incomplete, truncated version, when you look at the issues of the evangelical and the Christian right, you will see an interesting historical development that took place, especially beginning in the 1830s. You remember in the 1830s, historically, there was a shift that was taking place from Calvinistic thinking. Calvinistic thinking focused on predestination. Amen, somebody. Predestination and deism were the primary school of thought in the early 1800s. Predestination simply suggested that, yes, there is salvation, but God has already predetermined who will be saved, and only those who are under divine special selection will be saved. Are you with me? So if you were not a part of a select group, salvation was impossible for you. There was nothing you could do about it. God already determined who would be saved. That's at the heart of Calvinistic thinking. The opposite was deism. Deism was a concept that, yes, God did create the world. Yes, God made it. But when God finished making the world, God stepped back and left the world to itself. And all humankind that were left on the world had to figure out for themselves what they were going to do, because there was no divine intervention. It was in this religious and culture and philosophical climate that there was a new birth that took place in Protestantism called the Evangelical Movement, which suggests that yes, there is a God who has salvation, but salvation is not limited to just a few. But there is such a thing of moral actions and moral choice that if we choose to be saved, and if we behave a certain way, and if we accept Jesus Christ's life and death and resurrection, we too can embrace salvation. Amen, somebody. Moral choice and moral actions were proof of salvation. Don't lose the point there. Charles Finney, the great evangelist, taught that religion was more than what we think. Religion was also something we must do. To prove that you are saved, there was something you must do. There is actions that demonstrated that you belong to Christ. There was this shift in thinking that, yes, salvation was available to all people, but you also had to work towards it. Yes, there was grace, but grace by itself wasn't enough. You must demonstrate your faith by doing something, being something. That's why Charles Finney, that when during his evangelism thrust, when there was great preaching and there was great camp meetings, you know, the spirit of camp meeting, where we saw revivals and the second great awakening take place. Long before the Adventist church was existing, camp meeting existed. There was also something I mentioned earlier during this period of time. It was what was called, Dr. Lee, it was a protracted meetings. Come on now. You want to know what a protracted meeting is? See, here, a protracted meeting was that during a great revival week, that people would get together for church. And they would come to church at 7, 8 o'clock in the morning. And they would have prayer time for about 2 or 3 hours. Hello. After prayer time, they would have some study time for a couple of hours. Are you with me? And when it came time for the sermon, that there was no such thing as a short sermon. Hello, that the sermon was 2, 3, 4 hours long. It would take an hour just to get the introduction out. They were protracted. I think we ought to try a protracted meeting. Have one of those 4-hour preaching services that we just open the word of God and just stay the course until something happens. The protracted meetings. Y'all looking at me like, don't you do no protracted meeting today. Protracted meetings. It was also during this period where conversion became critically important. Conversion, this encounter with God, this surrender of life, that when one was converted, when one was changed, when one gave their heart to God and accepted God, Charles Finney also taught that to become a Christian meant you automatically signed up to be an abolitionist to fight against slavery. That Christianity and social reform took place. To be a Christian meant you cared about society. You cared about temperance. You cared about prohibition. You cared about women's suffrage. You cared about what was happening. To sign up to be Christian meant you must do something. I wish we had that in Adventism today. I wish that we understood that when you were baptized, you were not baptized to be a pew warmer. That you signed up to be involved. That you signed up for social justice. That you signed up to care about people. That's what it meant to be a Christian during the Second Great Awakening. The evangelical movement was developing in itself, and it was raising its awareness, and it was teaching the social consciousness. You remember how this worked not only in the religious realm, but it also worked in Parliament. You remember William Wilberforce, how he was the one who was converted to Christ and was in Parliament there in Britain and in British, and he worked in Parliament after his conversion to bring about the Slave Act of 1807. Slavery was abolished in Britain long before it was abolished in America. It came because individuals who were Christians understood that they had a social responsibility to change the plight of other people. Don't miss that. I want to suggest one of the challenges we have, which has been suggested, that perhaps, Dr. Lee, you can help us. Perhaps the whole social consciousness, what we teach in our Adventist church, ought to be connected. What we teach in our Adventist school, that we ought to graduate individuals who have a stronger social consciousness. To sign up for Jesus, to graduate from our school, it automatically means that we must have an imprint in society. That was critically important. That was the nutshell of what was taking place in the evangelical movement, evangelical Protestantism. And we have seen the results of that. We saw even in the how it impacts even the civil rights movement, how there was a social consciousness, and we're so grateful for the civil rights movement. Amen, someone. The period of time that people are still trying to erase or forget about. We are grateful for it because it was in the church. It was in the church that mobilized our people to action. It was a church that trained us and equipped us. The church was a platform that we have, and praise God, we use the platform. Amen, someone. No issue about being silent, what we can't talk about. That was the only place we had voice, and we took advantage of that voice. By the time we made our way to the 1980s, of course, missing many years, and those of you who are true historians, you will understand the time periods that already elapsed. But get into the 1980s, there was a shift in the evangelical movement, which was really called the Christian Right. Evangelical movement on steroids, if you please. Individuals like Jerry Falwell and Pat Robinson wanted to push the agenda further. In fact, the push was that if you're really a Christian, then Christians should absolutely control what happens in the political realm in society. A moral majority, if you please, where government should legislate moral behavior. Stay with me now. That government should legislate moral behavior. Now, mind you, God always gives the freedom of choice. Even in a society that can legislate moral behavior, you're not going to have the desired outcomes because you're still dealing with fallen humanity. It's the nature of the beast, no matter how perfect. And the other issue that is behind this notion, the theological issue about a better America, about a moral America, it moves against the Adventist theological understanding that in this world, things are not going to get better, they're going to get worse. That there will not be a year of peace and prosperity that exists in this earth. Earth's history is not going to get better, it's only going to get worse. But those who frame the question are allowed to have the discussion. They're allowed to be at the table, and the propaganda and the media takes place, and we follow along arguing issues that are really not our issues in the first place. We ought to put our agenda out there, raise our questions, instead of following everybody else's questions. So today we have these issues taking place, and they're complex issues. They're clear biblically, they're clear in the church, but they create such controversy and issues in the workplace and in secular society. In fact, it has created this great divide that if you are a Christian, if you stand by the Bible, you are considered archaic and outdated. You are labeled as being a bigot and out of touch with reality because others have been allowed to frame our questions. So now we vote on same-sex unions or marriage. We have a discussion that divides us on abortion. They frame the question. They raise the issue of the federal budget or the size of government, the unemployment, wars, and Israel. Israel has become the critical issue because there is a misunderstanding and a misinterpretation of Bible prophecy, and we are caught responding to other people's questions. So it was Jesus who was posed with the question of the day. The text says again, Luke 20, verse 20, so they watched him and sent spies who pretended to be righteous. I don't know about you, there's nothing more disgusting than a pig using God talk, pretending to be righteous. that they may seize on his words in order to deliver him to the power and the authorities of the governors. So then they ask him, saying, Teacher, we know that you say and teach rightly, and you do not show personal favoritism, but teach the way of God in truth. You see, if your ego gets in the way, that statement by itself will mess you up. When someone starts flattering you to set you up, I promise you it's a setup. You know, sometimes you just look at people with a hard stone with my New York look, and in my mind I'm thinking, what do you want? What? And you know, it comes out, what? What's wrong? You just look at them.
That's right.
The love of Christ constraineth us. Where were we? We're back here. But he perceived their craftiness and said to them, Why do you test me? Show me the money. Give me a penny, a denarius. Whose image and inscription does it have? Whole lot of sermons and preach right there. They answered and said, Caesar's. And he said to them, Render therefore to Caesar's the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God. But they could not catch him in his word in the presence of the people, and they marveled at his answer and kept silent. Jesus made a fool out of us again. Whose image is on it? What is interesting, not only the question, but Jesus was clearly establishing a concept and the principle that the Jewish people and the Jewish leaders need to understand. You do know that the Jewish leaders taught that they said it was unlawful for them to pay taxes to Caesar. It was against the law of Moses. And they were trying to find a way out of it. It was against the law of Moses. It's also interesting that this question was asked not because they were concerned about the people. They were concerned about power, and they were looking for an opportunity to get Jesus. The question had everything to do with their hatred for Jesus. Let's get him. Let's ask a question that will bring his end. If he says, yes, it's lawful to pay taxes, then those that are following him who are upset with taxes will be angry at him. If he says, no, it's not, we don't have to pay taxes, then they would turn him over. They would turn him over to authorities to have him crucified. So they said, we got Jesus in a no-win situation. Sometimes people just want a yes or no answer, but sometimes the question demands more than that. Because some people frame questions trying to box you in. Just give me a yes or no. Does God love everyone? Then why then are we opposed to people marrying whoever they want to? Give me a yes or no.
I got to take you through the Word of God. I got to give you a biblical worldview. I got to march you through creation first. I got to talk about what it means to be made in the imago Dei, in the image of God. I got to talk to you what God put in man and put in woman, and why he brought them together, and what together they can produce, how in each other they are to reflect the image of God, that without each other, God is incomplete. I got to have a full conversation to answer the question. It is not yes or no. Yes or no, and so he... So the coin, whose image is on this coin? Caesar. Jesus could have paused and told his creation, look in this mirror. Whose image is on the mirror? Render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar. But render unto God the things that are God. God introduced these parallel, these twin important answers that in this world, that there are obligations and commitments that we have under those who are rulers over us. Yes, we must adhere. And yes, we must pay. I can't get the word out. Don't want to get the word out. We must pay that T word, that T-A-X. Yes, we must pay taxes. That's what the government requires. But when it comes to God, there's another image that you should reflect, and you must render to God the things that belong to God. Amen, someone. He silenced them.
Servant Lord says when he told those leaders to render to Caesar the things of Caesar, it was an indictment against them. It was an indictment. Says that if they had faithfully followed God, that they would not have been under human rule. But because they rejected God, their penalty was they were subjected to human rule. I want to suggest to you that enslavement always takes place when we turn from God. That when we turn from God, there was always something or someone else that controls us. Freedom only comes when you serve to God. Freedom, Jesus says that I am the way, the truth, and the life, that he has come to set us free. That freedom only comes, true freedom comes when we turn our hearts to God. Are you with me? Yet when you look at this issue, there is that other critical question that sometimes folk ask. Okay, so in society, what are we to do? We have this dual responsibility. We are children of God and children of society. What then should be our response? Notice how Jeremiah 29, 4 through 7 answers this important question. It's talking to the people of God that have gone into Babylonian exile. They are now captives. They're not free people anymore. Notice how Jeremiah 29 responds. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I have carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters to marriage, so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in numbers, do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. God was saying, you might as well, where you are, learn how to live there. Take advantage of what exists, because if the city prospers, you too will prosper. That's why you better watch what you're complaining about. As though you're going to be exempt if something happens. If the city prospers, God's people will also prosper. Somebody say amen. Well, yesterday, I'm winding down. Yesterday, I had the privilege to vote early. Yeah. I had the privilege. Normally, I wait for election day, but I wanted to do something. It was Dr. Hill was a part of my sermon preparation. So I needed to go vote early on yesterday. So I went over to our PG library and I saw this incredible line for early voting. And the weather wasn't as warm as I thought it would be. And I got out and said, okay, I'm going to go stand in line for 3.5 hours for early voting. Hello now. I said I voted early. Oh, I'm coming to that now. I did vote. Hello now. I'm about to. So I stood in line for 3.5, but it was a part of an experiment.
Yes.
You see, when you go to vote, when you have your cane go on backwards, you have your boots on and your jacket over so you can blend in with everybody else. So I wanted to talk to people, because I know we had 14 questions and some critical issues that were taking place. I wanted to get a feel of what was going on. So I'm there hanging out with folk, and we just having good conversation until this one Adventist cop came up, not here, who almost blew my cover. And came, hey, Pastor Miller, man, shh, move out of the way, man. I'm working here, man. I said, no, man, I can get you up. You don't have to. I said, I need to wait. I'm doing something here. I had surround me. The Lord always orchestrates the right people at the right time. I had a young lady behind me who was declared a lesbian. And she was there to vote, of course, in favor of same sex. And behind her were two of her friends, and behind them were there some of our people who were in total opposition. And so they were having not discussion but debates. In my immediate circle, there was a Catholic person and two other women there, two other Caucasian women. We were having discussions about the Board of Education and about other issues. And of course, question 6 and question 7 were the critical issues that everyone was talking about. Same-sex marriage and the issue of gambling. Those were the critical issues. And we had great dialogue. I got a chance to talk to them about a biblical worldview versus a secular worldview. I got to talk to them about human rights versus human choice. Hello now. I talked to them about that God respects all people. And that God values all people. And that if we break down conversation with a certain class of people because we don't agree with their lifestyle, then how are we going to influence them when we can't even talk to them? And of course, one religious person immediately got on board and said, yeah, but the Bible says, they didn't know who I was, but the Bible says that God made man and woman. I said, yes. And in the Garden of Eden, God also gave man and woman the power of choice. And they chose to disobey God. And that God is so good, God is so great, that God in his covenant relationship would tell you that if you follow me, here are the blessings. And if you disobey me, here are the curses and the consequences. That God always gives choice, even when you make the wrong choice, God will tell you first. And while I'm talking, my lesbian new friend is listening. Never been to church a day in her life. Never read a Bible a day in her life. Knows nothing about the Word of God. How am I going to impose my biblical worldview on someone who's never even read the Bible and assume they're going to answer because I'm over here and they're over there? But I promise I was not going to alienate. I'm going to have conversation and dialogue. I'm going to understand what the critical issues are. I'm going to see how we can build consensus without compromise. You see, to listen and have a conversation with someone who believes differently doesn't mean that I'm compromising my position or my beliefs. Because if the gospel is going to reach all people, and folk are going to hear the gospel from us, then we got to present the gospel in the way that others will hear it. Oh, I know I'm messing some of you up already. Because I know that there are some Adventists who can't even have this conversation. In fact, some Adventists are so confused about their own Adventist identity that they can't talk about anything else. But God has called us to be thinkers, not reflectors of other men's thoughts. And God calls us to do this. If we're going to reach all people, if we're going to break strongholds, if the Holy Spirit is going to bring about transformation to people, we must take the gospel to unpopular places also. Lord have mercy, help me Jesus. And so we got to talking about things and yeah, it deviated because I saw somebody had a Dallas Cowboy hat on and somebody else had a Redskin jacket on and it just, you know, I had to pull out my giant truth and, you know, they started leaving me, pardon the way, but I had to call them. So it was a good conversation anyway. But I want all of them to get something. While we were making our way around, I told them, and I'm gonna tell you, here's where I'm going. I said all this to get to this point. So there are four things that I carried with me when I came to vote today. Four things. By this time, they began to ask, and my police friend came back and was talking to me about pastor. And they said, oh, you're a pastor. See, for the last 2.5 hours, you didn't know that. Praise the Lord. So but there are four things that I'm carrying with me to my voting booth. What is that? First of all, I'm carrying my faith. You see, I still believe that God's got the whole world in his hands. I still believe that God controls and sets up rulers and takes them down. I carry my faith with me because I vote, but I trust in God. God knows what's best. God knows what we need in our future. I told him I carry my faith. I told him I'm a Seventh-day Adventist and I'm proud to be an Adventist. And I carry my faith wherever I go. I never take it off. It's a part of me. It's glued to my body. It's in my mind and it's in my heart. I carry my faith every place. And I told them you ought to carry your faith with you also. That whatever you believe in God, carry God. Don't be ashamed to carry God with you. Carry him in your heart and in your mind. Second thing I told them. That I carry my faith. Then I told them in a mixed multitude of people, different colors, different walks of life, I told them I also carry my history with me. Yeah. That I'm here with the freedom to vote because somebody else suffered for me. I said, every time I stand in a voting booth, I'm reminded I'm standing on the shoulders of individuals who lost their lives and lost everything for my right to vote. That's why I got a major issue when I hear any African-American pastor standing up in his pulpit trying to tell his African-American congregation not to vote. You are a sellout. You've forgotten your own history. I don't care who you vote for. You get up and vote. It's a right to vote. That's why I can't tolerate folk who are eligible to vote, who are registered to vote, and who don't vote. One thing, you can't vote. And I know there are folk who wish they had the right to vote. But if you have the right to vote and you don't, shame on you. Shame on you. You're spilling blood all over again. Yes, you are. You are spilling it all over. Shame on you. I carry my faith. I carry my history. Third thing I tell them I carry my gratitude. Talk about my country all you want to, but I'm glad to be an American. I'm glad to be in a land where I can speak my mind. I have the right to vote. I have the right to worship any way I want to. That if things continue, I'll continue to have the right to health care. We have the right to public education. We have the right to fair housing if we get the right realtors. That I carry gratitude with me. As bad as this country is, as bad as its history is, I'm glad to be an American. Talk about my country all you want to. Yes, it doesn't have some of the warmth and some of the fruit and some of the culture that exists around this world. But when it all boils down, God has placed me here. I'm in a land where I'm not persecuted for what I believe. I'm in a land that my power still comes out. I'm in a land that I have to walk miles to get water. I'm in a land where they don't stop me because I look different and stand different. I'm in a land of the free. I'm an American. And that matters to me. As bad as it is, it means something. Means something to have rights. Means something to go to a voting booth and vote my conscience, and there's no one standing over me with a gun telling me what I have to do. Carry my faith. Carry my history. I carry my gratitude. Then I told them I carry something else that matters. Fourth thing I carry my hope. I carry my hope. Yeah, you see, my hope, my hope is not in a better America. My hope that there is a God who sits high and he's controlling everything that is low. That Daniel tells me that there was an image built. And that the feet of the image, that feet of clay, that there was a stone that came out and crushed that image, and that stone grew into a great mountain. Daniel tells me that one day God's going to set up his everlasting kingdom, that there's going to be a day that there'll be no more wars and no more trials and no more tribulation, that I won't have to worry about Republicans or Democrats, because in that great day, King of Kings, Lord Jesus, will set up his eternal throne, that the King is coming. That's my hope. Oh, I vote, but I got hope. I carry my history, but I got hope. I carry my gratitude, but I got hope, because God is in control of this. And although this world will perish, there's going to be another world. There's a better day coming after a while, that Jesus is coming soon. That's the hope I carry. That's what we do. And then I said, well, Jesus, if Jesus, we agreed that after we voted, that we're going to have a post meeting, exchange numbers and talk about what we voted for. A few of us agreed to do it. And we came out and shared our position. And then I thought, what if Jesus was doing an exit poll? What would matter with Jesus? When I disclose my votes, when I talk about what's important, what matters most, Jesus, what will you be impressed with? What matters most? If I told you I voted for the redistricting of the eight areas in Maryland, If I told you I voted in favor of city governments being able to borrow schools for to build orphanages and to build schools and roads, what would Jesus be impressed with? Would he be impressed with how I vote against gambling? Would he be impressed with how I vote for or against same sex? What would matter with Jesus? You want to know what Jesus thinks? You got to go to Jesus' book.
That's right.
And Matthew chapter 25, starting at verse 31, gives me an answer. When Jesus says that he'll call all the nations together and he will separate the sheep and the goats, the righteous and the unrighteous, and he will say to the righteous, enter into my Father's joy. Enter into my house. Why, Lord? Because when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was sick, you came and visited me. Jesus will say, enter into my joy. And to the others who are cast into damnation in the lake of fire that is prepared for the devil and his angels, he will say to them, why? Because when I was in need, you didn't do it to the least of me. Oh, I get it now. That Jesus has a real concern about the social gospel that penetrates and reaches those who cannot help themselves. That our Christianity is going to be measured on the power that we have. Do we use it for ourselves or do we use it for the least of these? Oh, don't miss that point. Don't miss that point.
That's right.
So maybe it's not all what we hear in the media. Maybe they have formed the wrong questions. Maybe the question, the only question that matters when we vote, are we voting on the side of Jesus? Do we understand Jesus' politics? Voting for those who cannot help themselves. That's who I vote for. That's who I speak for. So today, I want you to vote. Yes, I do. I want you to vote. I want you to have your discussions. But I want you to carry those four things with you. Carry your faith. Carry your history. Carry that gratitude. Carry your hope. Every election reminds us this thing is winding up. You know, there's so many spins on the storm, and I don't like using other people's suffering as opportunities. I don't believe in that. I don't believe in exploiting that. But I couldn't resist myself. I couldn't help that, you know, when you're doing right, even your enemies will praise you. I'm just saying what the Bible says. When you look at the storms, Joe was right. We don't look up, our redemption draws nigh. You hear the scientists trying to explain the mass, the historical size and proportion of it's never happened before and so forth. Well, turn to the Word of God. These things will come to pass. But don't you get discouraged. Don't you grow weary in doing well. We shouldn't be surprised. We should be prepared, equipped, ready to go. That's what God calls us to do. We are at a most pivotal time in earth history, and God has allowed us to be alive, to see it in techno living color. Prophecy being fulfilled right in front of us. God has kept you and me alive to experience it while it's happening. In the midst of everything that's going on, keep looking heavenward. Vote, but look up. Engage, but look up. Be involved, but look up. As our redemption draws nigh. Oh, Father in heaven.
Amen.
Today, Lord, I thank you that in the midst of all the political pundits and spins that go on that we can't avoid, that there is a clear word that comes from you. Lord, we don't have to get caught up in what man is saying, because we are anchored in the Lord. We know what you are doing, Lord, and we ask you to guide and direct us in the days ahead. In the midst of our storms, guide us, bless us, be with your people. I pray for the discouraged, they will find new hope. I pray, Lord, for the confused, that they will get clarity and purpose. I pray, Lord, for the faithless, that they will gain faith. And I pray that the faithful will remain strong. Oh, Lord, guide your people today. Bless us in our doings. Keep your hand upon us. Lord, I need to make an appeal today. I need to make an appeal for the people of God to have courage to stand for the right and to do what's right, regardless of political climates, regardless of storms and trials. I need for God's people to say that we will not be tossed to and fro, but that we will stand firm on Christ, the solid rock today. If today you're under the sound of my voice, and today you have a renewed commitment to understand that the choice between Caesar and Jesus is most importantly a choice for Jesus first. Once we get that right, everything else falls into place. Once we are committed to the sovereign God, then all of the issues find their rightful place. If today you want to recommit your lives back to this great God, the God that controls all governments, all principalities and powers, the God who controls not only the world, but this great God who also controls our lives. If you want to recommit your life to him, I invite you to stand even now. As an act of commitment, those who have due citizenship, citizens of this world, but thank God, citizens of the world to come. Oh God, look at your people standing, recommitting our lives to thee. I pray, Lord, that your word was received with clarity and purpose. Untainted, Lord, by human sinfulness, but received in hearts and minds through the movement of the Holy Spirit. Seal in our hearts and our minds what we have received. Give us courage to move forward. When we vote, to carry our faith, to carry our history, to carry our gratitude, most importantly, to carry our hope. Bless us to this end, I pray. Bless your people. Bless your country. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. God bless you.